Good morning. The death toll from the Turkey-Syria earthquake is still rising rapidly. Now close to 8,000 people have been confirmed dead. There is still hope of life in the rubble, though, with survivors incredibly being pulled out days after the disaster hit. Correspondent Brett McLeod reports from Adana in southern Turkey.
Well, this is the scene that's been continuing here for the past couple of nights. All that debris, the dust, and the noise coming off what was once an apartment block up until the earthquake struck. And they're still hopeful, despite what it looks like, there may be people still inside. This is a scene that's being repeated right across Turkey and into Syria as well. Thousands upon thousands of people have been rescued. We've seen some extraordinary sights, particularly involving children just in the past 24 hours, drawn out of buildings where it didn't look like it was possible anyone could have survived, and yet they did, to the enormous relief of their families and rescuers.
They got a lot of places, buildings fell down, lots of people die. In here, almost like 45, 50 people die here. You know, a couple of them, they don't die, but almost 50 people die here.
The conditions here are getting more difficult, though. It's very cold here in Adana. It's much colder in other parts of the country and in Syria, where snow is forecast, and of course more rain, which is going to make life even more difficult. The rescue workers are committed to continuing as long as they can until they're certain there are no more people to be rescued.
Meanwhile, Melbourne's Turkish community is harnessing people power to get urgent supplies over to Ground Zero. Volunteers are working around the clock, packaging and sorting through desperately needed donations. Isabella Stashkovsky met with them.
Well, the Turkish community here in Melbourne is certainly coming together, filling up these shipping containers with donations. We're at the back of the Sultan Halal Meats and Poultry Butcher in Campbellfield. I'm going to bring in Bea. She's one of the volunteers here. What's the response been like from the community so far, Bea?
So far, the community has come together and we appreciate their support, and it's continuing, which is fantastic. As you can see behind us, we've actually got flocks of brand new blankets, tents and sleeping bags, because that's what they need, because it's very cold in Turkey at the moment.
What are you asking for the community? What can people do who are watching for the next few days?
For the next few days, if you've got manpower to come out and volunteer, more than happy for you guys to come down and join in and do your bit. Second thing is, obviously, we need brand new. The more we've got, the more we can give back. And the third thing is, we're actually asking the airlines to get this stuff from Melbourne to a hub city via air freight to get there as quick as possible.
But what about the emotional toll? How does that work? How are you all supporting each other through this incredibly hard time?
There's a lot of tears flowing when we get news that someone's passed or that's come out of the rubble. Even though we're not there, we're actually living it and feeling it. And everyone is, you know, putting their hands on their hearts, and they're actually doing what they need to do.
Bea, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
As you can see here, this is the situation right now. There's so many goods that are being donated that is just overflowing. They are only expecting more of these goods to be coming throughout the day. Certainly also expecting some more shipping containers and two semi-trailers to come from Sydney in order to take these goods and put it all together. The aim, of course, is to get it over to Ground Zero as soon as possible.
And anyone who wishes to donate for the relief effort can head to one of these links on your screen now: UNICEF, CARE or Oxfam. Well, after a ninth straight interest rate hike from the Reserve Bank, there are concerns some Australians may struggle to keep up with mortgage repayments. Let's go live now to federal politics reporter Eliza Edwards. Eliza, the pressure on households is only going to get worse.
Absolutely, Lizzie. We saw the Reserve Bank inflict yet another rate rise on borrowers yesterday, taking that official cash rate to 3.35%. And the RBA governor flagged more increases to come this year. The Treasurer says the financial situation will get harder for many households, particularly because there's around 800,000 people coming off fixed-term loans in the coming months. The opposition has raised concerns we could start to see an increase in people defaulting on their loans and potentially being forced to sell their homes. Jim Chalmers says he is watching this situation closely.
I'm concerned about the pressure on Australians with a mortgage as interest rates rise. I mean, I think that's pretty obvious. And we haven't yet seen large-scale, broad-scale defaults on loans, but people are under increasing pressure.
And Lizzie, for those still trying to break into the housing market, a new survey from the Property Council paints a picture of just how difficult it is. 81% of Australians reporting there were no affordable homes in their area. 52% of people say they have no other option but to rent, and 72% say the reason is they simply can't save fast enough for a deposit.
Australia is now known to be a global laggard when it comes to creating affordable home for its people. Demographia's International Housing Affordability 2022 report ranked Australia as severely unaffordable. Sydney was the second least affordable market among 92 globally surveyed.
Lizzie, the federal government says it is taking steps to address this, introducing legislation tomorrow for a housing affordability future fund to finance new and affordable homes.
Eliza, thank you. There's a new dire warning today about the state of our health system, with thousands of patients waiting in public hospitals because they can't be discharged into aged or disability care. A report from the Australian Medical Association warns of an exit block of around 20,000 patients, with a more than 35-day wait for some before discharge. The AMA warns it's costing the health system up to $2 billion a year, and it is urging the federal government to respond. Two people are in hospital this morning after a crash on the Sydney Harbour Bridge, which caused peak hour traffic delays. The two cars colliding on the bridge while going in opposite directions at 7:45 last night. A 17-year-old had minor facial injuries, and a 59-year-old man suffered a medical episode. Scaffolding underneath a major bridge in Brisbane has given way. Part of the temporary structure underneath the Walter Taylor Bridge collapsed last night. Several emergency service crews converged on the area, but no one was injured. Train speed restrictions were in place until authorities secured the site. A plastic manufacturing business has gone up in flames in Melbourne's southeast, sending toxic smoke into the air. Investigators are still trying to piece together what caused the blaze. Gillian Lantouris has the story.
Firefighters are still here on scene trying to put out spot fires after the building caught fire more than 6 hours ago. A patrolling police member raised the alarm after spotting smoke billowing from the administration office just before 5:30 this morning. It wasn't long before the entire Olive Grove building went up in flames. Thankfully, no one was inside at the time.
It's a bit tough to take. I've got the guys here. We're ready for production. It's really shattering to arrive and be confronted with this.
The fire was so severe, 120 firefighters were called in to contain the blaze. The fumes so toxic, residents within 2 kilometres were told to stay inside and shut their doors.
Mainly that everybody's safe and secure. Life is have to go on, but still is people losing a lot of jobs.
The factory is home to a plastics manufacturing company, which has operated for 40 years. The fire took more than 2 hours to bring under control.
We've certainly got the appropriate insurances, but a lot of time and a lot of money is going to be required here to get this thing back on the track that we need it to.
It's estimated millions of dollars worth of machinery and stock has been lost, and part of the building will have to be demolished.
With all the challenges, COVID, everything else, absolutely, just when we've kind of got a little bit of a clear run up ahead of us in 2023, we've got another challenge that we've got to face up to.
The cause of the fire is under investigation, and it won't be until firefighters can make it safe enough to get inside the building to determine exactly what caused the blaze.